Hey guys, it's Dani. Welcome to another episode of our Orchid Care series. Today we will talk about what to do with our orchid when all of the flowers are spent. How should we treat it so that we ensure it will grow healthy and it will rebloom for us in the future? We shall address all of that today, including a few care tips for these orchids. And as always, this video is sponsored by repotme.com, which offers you everything you could need to properly take care of your orchids, from media to fertilizer and even pest control. If you're into bonsais or African violets, they do have something for you as well, so I'll link their website down below. Feel free to visit them anytime. But today, let's talk about our beautiful Phalaenopsis orchids, which delighted us with their blooms for the past few months. Phalaenopsis orchid flowers can remain open and beautiful on the plant for a few months, provided you know a few tricks and you avoid a few things. In our last episode, we discussed just that. So if you missed it and would like to know how to extend the bloom time of your orchid, check the description down below. I will add a link to that video and all of the other episodes in the series. But even so, flowers will eventually start to dry and fall off. This is absolutely normal. The orchid will not stay in bloom forever, and it absolutely does not mean that your plant is sick or worse, it's going to die. But at this point, there are a few things that we should do for our orchid. So first of all, we can try to promote yet another blooming. When all the flowers are spent on your orchid, you will be left with these bare canes that you see here, which don't look very appealing, do they? Sometimes these spikes will remain green, and sometimes you will see the very tips starting to yellow or brown, and this yellowing can continue downwards. Both of these instances are absolutely normal. We can actually encourage another branch on the very same flower spike. We call it a secondary spike if we look further down on the flower spike. Now, in the places where flowers used to be, you will not get a secondary spike or another bud or anything of the sorts. So usually the top of the flower spike will not bloom again unless it starts to produce buds from the very tip. But in our case, we can see that the tip is already dried out, so it will not produce any more flowers and buds from the tip. So at this point, we can remove the bamboo stake and inspect a little bit this flower spike. We can see that the last place where a flower used to be is right here. So from all of these nodes, nothing will sprout. However, lower, we have active but dormant buds. Let's just give you a close up. These dormant buds are usually protected by a little sheath, which can be green or yellow and dried, such as in my case. If we peel it up, we can see that there is a little bud starting to swell here. Now, this bud can become one of two things: another flower spike with buds and flowers, or a baby plant. Baby plants, we call them keikis, are pretty rare in comparison to secondary spikes. Now, on some orchids, this bud will not already be inflated, such as in our case here. It doesn't matter, it could actually start growing again. So what you can do to encourage its growth is to cut the flower spike. So get yourself a pair of pruners or scissors, something sharp that you can cut the flower spike with, and locate the last dormant bud before the flowers start. So in my case, it is right here, it's pretty obvious. You have to give a clean cut, half an inch or 1 centimeter or so above this node. You can discard this part of the flower spike as it will not produce anything anymore, and leave this flower spike as it is on the plant. On the other flower spike, we can see yet again that we have an eye here. So we will do the very same thing, cut the flower spike 1 centimeter or 1/2 inch or so above it. Now, when you do this, you don't need to peel these little sheaths from the dormant eye. I did so just to show you the dormant eye, but if your orchid has a green sheath or even a dried little sheath, you don't need to peel it off, and it's better not to do so, especially if you're a beginner, because you might actually damage the dormant bud. And at this point, all you need to do is just wait and see what happens. In most cases, a brand new flower spike will arise from this node, maybe even from the one below it. It can take a few weeks for this to happen, so be patient. However, as I was saying, a baby plantlet could appear from here in rarer cases. You can also have a secondary spike and a baby plantlet, or in the worst case scenario, you will not have anything sprouting at all. This happens, and it happens quite often, so don't be upset if you will not have another secondary branch. You can always have a brand new flower spike in the flowering season, so don't worry about it, we will address that in a future video as well. More important than flowers, though, is the health of your orchid. So keep in mind, try to encourage another flowering only if your orchid is healthy. If the leaves are nice and glossy and green, they're stiff, you have an orchid with a good root system and otherwise healthy. After the initial flowers are spent, the orchid usually starts to grow vegetatively, meaning new leaves, new roots, and it's making sure that it will have energy to rebloom once again. Now, if the flower spike on your orchid is completely dry all the way to the stem of the plant, there will be no chance for a secondary spike or a keiki or anything else to sprout. So you are absolutely safe to cut it as close to the stem as possible. And of course, if your orchid is sick or recovering, it is better to just remove it and give the plant a chance to grow vegetatively. If by now you did not repot your orchid into fresh medium, it is a very, very good idea to do so. I'm actually going through the topic of repotting extensively in the first video of the series. In that instance, I actually dealt with pretty sick orchids which needed fresh new medium. And thus, I chose to repot them even before the flowers were spent. But if your orchid was in good condition or you simply did not repot until now, now is the moment to do so. The medium in which orchids come is usually not very fresh and sometimes it is even very broken down. It is better to give the new roots fresh new medium so they can develop properly and grow as much as they like. So it is a wonderful time to offer a bigger pot if your orchid has a lot of roots and fresh new medium. Do check out the first video in the series so you see what types of media you can use and other techniques related to repotting. New roots and leaf growth needs to be supported with proper culture, and one of the most crucial aspects of their culture is watering. It is now that we really need to offer adequate watering and make sure that the new structures grow healthy. The second episode of our series actually deals with watering Phalaenopsis orchids, so again, if you missed it, check the description down below. I go into a lot of detail on how to properly water the orchid, what is the best time of day, what type of water you should use, and so on and so forth, so do check the description to find that out. And together with proper watering comes proper fertilizing. The formation of new leaves, new roots, and even the new flower spikes needs to be supported with nutrients. So I will share with you down below the third episode of the series, which actually deals with fertilizing, and I elaborate a little bit more about fertilizing in that video. But offering nutrients to your orchid in this time of the year is actually crucial. There is a common myth which says that after flowering, the Phalaenopsis orchid actually goes dormant. In reality, nothing is further from the truth. After flowering, Phalaenopsis orchids burst with growth. Roots, leaves, even secondary branches and little plantlets. This is why it's important to offer water and nutrients and not just forget about your orchid. If after flowering the orchid has limpy and leathery leaves, there's something very, very wrong with your orchid. And I encourage you to take a look at the root system, repot the orchid into fresh medium, because chances are the old medium affected the root system. When in active growth, your orchid actually needs you more than it did when it was in bloom. Complementing watering and fertilizing is light quantity and temperature. Phalaenopsis orchids really don't appreciate direct hot sun. They will thrive in bright shade locations. You can even provide a little bit of morning sunshine in an eastern exposure, but do try to filter the hot sun at noon through a sheer curtain, or simply don't place your orchid very close to the window if you know sun will hit the leaves. For a little while, try to see if the leaves actually heat up. If they do, there is a great risk that they will burn. So do try to provide bright shade, not darkness, but not necessarily direct sunshine, and your orchid will be just fine. When it comes to temperature, Phalaenopsis are not picky. They really do adore the same temperature that you like. So try to aim for intermediate temperatures, not too hot, not too cold. If you're comfortable, your orchid will be comfortable as well. Also, Phalaenopsis are not very picky when it comes to overall humidity. Just make sure your orchid is very well hydrated, and low humidity will not be an issue even in your home. One thing you might encounter in this period is the yellowing and drying of the bottom leaves. Don't be scared, in most cases this is absolutely normal. Phalaenopsis orchid leaves do regenerate with time, and these are very, very old leaves. So if they dry and fall, it is absolutely normal. You can have one or two leaves from the bottom starting to yellow. The important structures are at the top. That's why the Phalaenopsis orchid keeps growing new leaves year after year. It needs them because the old ones eventually will fall off. If, however, you have brand new leaves starting to yellow and fall, that's a problem, and we will address common Phalaenopsis problems in a future video, but just know that bottom leaves yellowing is absolutely normal, and you can have between 1 to 3 very old leaves yellowing and falling. With time, the leaves of your Phalaenopsis might actually accumulate some dust. You can absolutely remove the dust, it is recommended that you do so, and the way to safely do it is by using a paper napkin or a cotton disc or cotton ball, soak it up, and simply swipe the upper side of the leaf. When you clean the leaves of your orchid, never swipe on the underside. This is where the stomata, the breathing mechanism of the orchid, is located, and you can actually clog it with this motion. So just make sure that the upper side is nice and clean. The underside typically will not accumulate dust, so there is actually no need to clean it. With good care all year round, your orchid will actually rebloom on brand new flower spikes year after year. But this usually happens in winter or the beginning of spring. So we will talk more about reblooming Phalaenopsis closer to their season, but for now you should be set with your Phalaenopsis orchid. Just remember to watch the videos down below in the description regarding repotting, fertilizing, watering, and even extending the life of the blooms of your Phalaenopsis. And remember, just because your orchid doesn't have flowers anymore, it doesn't mean it's sick or that it will die. Hang on to it, take care of it, and it can reward you with even better blooms than when you first purchased it. Alrighty then, so that's about it for today. I hope you've enjoyed today's topic and that you will have blooms upon blooms of beautiful moth orchids for years to come. Stay tuned for future episodes when we will talk more about the orchid pot you should choose for your orchid, how to rebloom Phalaenopsis, and other interesting topics related to these orchids. So make sure you subscribe to stay up to date with all of these topics. Thank you so much, RepotMe, for making this series possible. And with that said, I will see you all next time. Bye!